Frank, you.
Hello, Frank, yes, I know. Hi, how are you?
Hello there.
Mind the ledger?
Daniel Key from Buffalo, New York, Jack Kemp's constituent.
Good to see you and have you here. From the Jack Kemp of Chicago, Mr. President.
Well, please, I do want to take this opportunity to thank Frank Meehan, who's done a great job as our ambassador to Poland, and also Jack Scanlon, who's going to succeed him. His experience in Eastern European affairs in the State Department, knowledge of Poland will serve us well. Last week, I nominated Ed Derwinski here to be the counselor to the State Department, and I hope that the people of the Polish-American community are as proud of him as I am. I hope he'll do a job and has the qualifications to make that connection post for him. Your mailgram is being studied, and I think you all realize that Poland remains a top priority of our administration. And beyond that, I will say I'm deeply grateful for the support that I continue to have from all of you and from the Polish American community. And I know that the time is very limited here, but in a few minutes, I'll stop talking and say that maybe somebody has a question they'd like to ask.
I may do so. On behalf of the Polish American community and Polish American Congress, I want to express our appreciation for the appointment of Ed Derwinski. I think you made a great choice, because Ed's been in my community for a great, great many years. And he does have the knowledge that is necessary to really work for all Americans.
Yes.
And particularly, Mr. Meehan, Powers has done a great job. I was so grateful for him, but you have a good replacement also, Jack Scanlon. And we feel highly, highly elated that a man of that caliber will go to Poland to represent the interests of the United States. And lastly, we certainly are grateful to you for your compassion and the great interest that you have shown to the cause of the people of Poland and your strong position against the Soviet, because as we all understand, the real culprit is the Soviet Union. But then the Poles are recipients of all that's bad that's coming out at the present time. So our mailogram, as well as the memorandum we have submitted, more or less summarizes our interests, our concerns, and support of the work that you have been doing, and you can always count on our support.
President, if you had seen the editorial in the Chicago Sun-Times over this weekend praising you for your appointment of Ed Derwinski, you'd think he wrote it himself. Brilliant editorial praising him very highly because of his background, his experience, and editorializing on a great, great appointment that was. So you should feel. We'll send you a copy.
Well, now, I've got to be grateful to Ed for that, because the Sun-Times does not normally find me doing that.
But you'd like to know about it. The other thing I want to congratulate you on, a statement you made the other day about the meaning of the pipeline in terms of basically giving the Soviet Union a whole new access of billions of dollars to build up their defenses. I think that statement ought to be articulated more often. I don't think the world really realizes what you're trying to do there.
I want you all to understand, we have continued to negotiate, and we're trying to with our European allies before we impose those. What we've been trying to negotiate is something that we think would be even more effective. So if so far we've got one major holdout against it, and what we would be willing to do is lift those sanctions for the existing contracts if we could be successful in getting what we think would be a much more stringent program involving all of us against Soviet Union.
Finally, I want to invite you to Chicago on the 13th of December. For the first anniversary of the tragedy in Poland, the martial law. So I'd like to have you in Chicago for the real round for it. No.
I don't know what the date is. There is an affair of a different kind that personal of Nancy and myself for a memorial service for her father there. But I don't know the exact date for that. And the reason that I can't answer you right now is, you know, I keep reading how powerful this position is supposed to be, except that somebody still tells me every day what I'm going to do every 15 minutes from that day. I don't dare say what I'm going to do until I find out what they plan for me.
Well, we're going to be leaving Jack Burgess over there to get you to Chicago for this anniversary.
Alderman Puchinsky's been unusually modest, for him. He's been unusually forceful and supportive, not just the policies applied to Poland, but more specifically the pipeline sanctions. And I would say, by and large, the Polish-American community is just 1,000% in support of the sanctions, recognizing the bigger picture, which is that the Soviet Union is the real culprit. And that's a point which European alliances fail to appreciate as much as, but it seems to be appreciated in the Polish-American community very well.
I'd just like the consensus on your default. We wholeheartedly support your position of no default. We don't agree with Lane Kirtland that it should be default really. I think that every one of us has that understanding, and we have real strong support on the part of the Polish American community.
I don't understand their failing to recognize that if that ever happens,
right,
you've let them off free, and all you've done is very seriously hurt the financial structure of our own country. It's like someone going bankrupt and they don't have any assets that you can claim to at least get back part of your money.
Absolutely.
So, I think we're, in fact, we'll be shortly, I'll be in a cabinet meeting with a discussion of that particular problem. If I could say just overall here, the thing about the Soviet Union also is that we recognize, and this is one of the reasons why so many people see a dichotomy in the grain deal, we recognize that the Soviet Union, economically, is in a very desperate situation, and the grain, this is for cash, and this is a hardship to them to have to come up with this, besides which there's no way that we could keep them from getting what they want, as we found out, but there's no one else that will join us in that particular type of embargo. But what we're also doing, try quietly, is I've never favored the kind of diplomacy or attempting to get something where you go out and on the front page of the newspaper put the other fella in a corner, in which then politically it's impossible for him to get out of that corner without losing face and prestige in his own constituency. So we have been quietly, what we're trying to do is indicate to the Soviet Union, particularly knowing their economic situation, that actions speak louder than words, and that all we're waiting for is to see some actions that indicate that they would really like to join the family of nations and get along, and then be able to do something that reveals to them that there are rewards for that. But all we've heard all these years of detente is words. While they go ahead with their great military build-up and with their, what they're doing with regard to Poland and all. So I've been trying to get quiet word to them, various sources, that do something. Do something that would then allow us, without putting in the paper or anything that we're doing, that we could show them what can happen in return for that. I always felt that the senators, Lord Senator Jackson, back several years ago with regard to Jewish immigration, when he made that a matter of an amendment, And was that, well, there was no way that they could back down in the eyes of their people, seemingly be dictated to by the Congress of the United States. Now, I happen to know of one president that we had who, if any of you remember back in 72 in the Brezhnev visit and the great meetings that all held out so much hope for peace for all of us. But I know at that time, our president took Mr. Brzezinski aside and said, I have a political problem in my country. And all of these things that we're talking about that you would like to see happen, it will be much easier for me if the right of Jewish immigration were evident in the Soviet Union. Now, there was nothing in the paper, there was never anything of quid pro quo or anything out there. Over the end of the year, 35,000 Jews had been allowed to immigrate. Well, this is, I believe in that kind of diplomacy, and so I believe that if we can continue to pursue that, so far I have to confess, we haven't seen any actions. There hasn't been any response, but we'll keep on trying. I think any of us likes the alternative.
Mr. President, amongst some immigrant exile leaders in our area, they think that that was a masterful off-microphone comment that you made, as it said, those lousy bums, that's really what though I know it brought up some strange comments.
Left
and they supported that.
We had trouble translating that into Poland.
I wondered about that, but I was going to say, I really didn't have any embarrassment about that. I don't know how you know how it happened. I was doing my radio, my 5-minute Saturday radio broadcast, and I was not aware that I know that the press room, the channel is open to them, so in the press room at the same time I'm doing the broadcast, they can hear it there in the press room. I didn't know that they turned the mic on early and that when they asked me to do a voice check, I usually just read a few lines of the script for them to get the voice check, sound check. And so the first lines, as you recall, having to do with the Polish leadership has done such and such and so, and then I just continued and said, they're a bunch of no good lousy bums. And the whole press room heard it, and that's the only thing that was broadcast about
it. Yeah. It might have disturbed the leadership, but the people loved it.
The words accepted.
I think that the Polish people would agree with you.
Find a way to translate them.
It was beautifully translated. Beautifully
I'm very pleased that you are pursuing what Al has said in his memo with the carrot approach also. I'm pleased you are saying quiet. You have to maintain or at least search for some dialogue with all parties involved. I mean, we can do our public pronouncements, and we can take our public positions, but the fact of the matter is, as you say, the final answer is going to be found in that quiet diplomacy. And I think Jack Scanning is a top-line guy.
The alternative, in my mind, has always been, and we mustn't fall into this trap, the alternative can get to be the mental feeling that war is inevitable. And I don't think any of us want to see in this day and age that kind of a war. And so I just believe that, and I believe that we've got a better chance while they themselves are as strapped as they are.
And I'm glad you can gray. It's not a show on TV. You're gray.
I say, listen, I'm glad I too. I don't have to argue that I diet anymore.
You've got strong support.
I know that, and I'm most grateful for it. I appreciate it very much.
Thank you very much.
I don't know if you know that. Can I take a second for a joke? I have become a collector of Russian jokes, of the jokes that the Russian people are telling, showing their cynicism about their own government, which must be a concern to their government. And this one was Brezhnev bringing his old mother to see his offices and so forth. And not a comment. And he put her in his limousine and took her to see his apartment in Moscow. Still no comment. Then he put her in his helicopter and out to his dacha there in the woods outside Moscow, his country home. No comment. finally in his private jet and down to the black sea to that marble palace he calls his beach cottage. And finally she spoke. She said, "Leonid, do the communists know?"
Thank you very much. I hate to be the timekeeper, but...